Next lecture by Dr. Avi Treves from the Sheba Cancer Research Center in Israel. He's the deputy director of the Cancer Research Center. And he will speak about stem cells and regenerative medicine from bench to clinic.
Good afternoon. I have to compete with time and this afternoon fatigue. So I skip most of the introduction, and also it was done very nicely by my previous speakers. So we are working on adult stem cells, not embryonic, not iPS. The lineages of stem cells you already heard about, pancreatic, endothelial, mesenchymal. And also I want to mention the immune cells which can be used for adaptive immunotherapy. All this field is including bone marrow transplantation with hematopoietic regenerative medicine and adaptive immunotherapy altogether is today termed cell therapy. Bone marrow transplantation, I'll give you a very overall description of some technologies which mature into clinical studies and into companies, mainly in Israel. Bone marrow transplantation, we know for more than 40, 50 years, today it is not a product, but it is a approved procedure, but there is a lot of industry around it. Industry of reagents, drugs, and devices. In the Sheba Medical Center, we are doing bone marrow transplant. It's the largest transplant center in Israel. Cord blood is one of the newest sources for hematopoietic stem cells, and since it's rich in stem cells, less histocompatibility needed, and reported similar clinical outcome are similar with when the source is bone marrow. The limitation is that it comes in small volume, and there are ways to overcome these limitations which I'll mention. At the Sheba Medical Center, we have done tens of bone marrow transplants with the cord blood as a source, and experimental protocols such as double cord transplants or expanded hematopoietic cells transplants. It is interesting to mention that the hematopoietic stem cells or stem cells from cord blood is entering today into additional clinical indication, not just for replacement of bone marrow or for hematopoietic malignancies, but also for other regenerative indications. In allogeneic combination, there are studies today on aplastic anemia, thalassemia, severe combined immunodeficiencies, and in autologous combination, which means cells are taken from private or family cord blood banking. There are clinical studies in diabetes type 1, acquired neurological diseases, hearing loss, traumatic brain injury, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, and autism. All of them are clinical studies, not approved protocols. The most advanced one is done by Joanne Kunzberg in Duke University, and it's on a very severe disease of early childhood babies, and its name is cerebral palsy. I'm not going into details, but she has done a large one-arm study of treating about 250 patients with babies with their own cord blood. They stole the cord blood and got very encouraging results, but she is very, very careful and is now doing a controlled two-arm studies, which has been approved already by the FDA and started in 2010. In order to overcome the smaller numbers of hematopoietic cells in cord blood, one of the approach which I was involved in was to develop ways to expand the stem cells with minimal differentiation, and we did it by introducing agents which inhibit differentiation and enabling proliferation. And I'll not go into details, but it took us a few years to develop the science around it, and then many more years to go into the translational research and have a product out of it, I think. Yes. So the product of the Midacel is Stemnex, expanded cord blood stem cells, and it is already finished phase one, and in February 2012, the company completed enrollment to phase three clinical studies, treating patients with allogeneic compatible cord blood expanded by the company method. Company was is supported by Teva and by Amgen, which means that some of the big pharma do enter into this field of cell therapy, but not too many of them. So we are now waiting for the results of the phase three clinical studies. And the company has a very nice pipeline of products. Now, just to show you how long it takes, I mean, the first publication about the technology was published in 2002, and in 2008, the publication about the phase one study, and still today, 2012, we don't have any products, so more than 12 years of developmental work. It needs a lot of patience and money in order to do it, but we are very hopeful that it will mature into a product. The embryonic sac, which is around the cord itself, it's a very good source of stem cells. I'll mention, in addition to the cord blood, the placenta, which is a source of all kinds of stem cells, the Walton jelly, the tissue around the vessels, and the amniotic fluid, and various groups, various companies are working and developing cell therapies from these sources. One such company is located in Israel, its name is Provistem, and they are aiming at first clinical indication, which is peripheral vascular disease. Again, I'm not going into details about the disease. They are using a 3D production method to develop large quantities of medicinal signaling cells in large quantities in 3D and introduce it by injection locally into the area of chronic wounds in such patients, and they are already in deep into phase two, and again with a very nice pipeline of products which I'm not entering into. Another Israeli company which is taking a different approach, actually it's worth mentioning, the Pluristem approach is allogeneic, which means they can produce large batches of a product and sell it to the need of the patients in need. And it is more of the pharmaceutical model of using cells as a therapeutics. The company which is aiming at treating ALS is using the autologous approach, taking stem cells from the bone marrow and differentiate them into neural cells and inject them locally intrathecal into the patient. And they've started phase one clinical study in the Hadassah Medical Center. Don't have results yet. So in Israel, there are about 15 companies which are doing cell product, cell-based development, and six of them are in clinical stage already, and I mentioned only few of them. The mesenchymal stem cells are, as we learned in the first lecture, very, very useful for treating various indications. At the Sheba Medical Center, we have now a pipeline of clinical development trying to enter into treatment of diabetic ulcers, retinal disease. We have preliminary results in each of them, but I will not describe them. Reconstructive plastic surgery and recovery of bone marrow. All these clinical programs are in various stages of development, and one of them was already, the first one, submitted to regulatory approval. The next story that I want to tell you is about adaptive cell therapy with lymphocytes to treat a devastating disease which is metastatic melanoma. And this again is done at the Sheba Medical Center based on a work developed at the NIH by Steve Weinberg, published the first clinical study in 2004, and the title of the publication is Cancer Regression in Patients with Metastatic Melanoma. There are zillions of papers on treatment of cancer only very few start with a sentence, cancer regression. So this is why we were very interested in this program and went to learn it and adapted it and actually further develop it in more into the Israeli environment. And it involves taking cells out of the metastatic tumor of the patient, processing them to large numbers and infusing it back into the patient together with high dose IL-2. It is done after myeloablation, which is similar to a procedure in the bone marrow transplantation. This is a scheme of the procedure. And by now, we treated already more than 50 patients. I'll show you the results. This is the product, some of the steps of the production line. Large quantities grown in 2-3 liters bags, then volume reduction, then at the end, the cell product, which consists of very large number of activated T cells infused back into the metastatic patient, which is a terminal in patients which is not responding anymore to any other available treatments. Now I'll show you a small clip about this protocol.
Danny is an Israeli composer and radio announcer. He's alive today thanks to the TIL treatment. A few years ago, he had metastatic melanoma, which spread to his lungs. Chemotherapy and all other existing treatments didn't help.
The way the situation, my melanoma was spread over my body, it was very, very dangerous. I mean, very, very dangerous. I was dying.
Shmuel is the director of a successful mall in a city in Israel. He has a warm family and many plans for the future. A few years ago, he discovered he had metastatic melanoma. Shmuel went through years of operations and different types of chemo, but nothing helped. Then I saw the doctor who said to me, "Shmuel, there's nothing we can do. The chemo's not working. Other materials aren't helping. That's it. Medicine can't help." So then I asked him if this was the verdict, because it was a death sentence. His reply was, "Statistically, in your condition, you have 10 months to live." After all the usual treatments of metastatic melanoma failed, Professor Jacob Schachter of the Ella Institute at the Sheba Medical Center suggested that Shmuel and Danny join an innovative clinical trial. This was the TIL treatment. Immunotherapy, which uses tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes, is designed for patients at an advanced stage of metastatic melanoma. T lymphocytes are white blood cells whose job it is to fight the tumor. However, due to a system failure in patients with metastatic melanoma, they are not sufficiently active, although they do exist at the site of malignancy. TIL treatment activates those TIL cells to fight the malignant tumor.
We usually receive tumor tissue after surgery from our patients, and from this tumor tissue, we isolate the cells, the tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes. We start usually with a very small amount and expand them in the end within a month to a huge amount. We get to about 5 or 50 billion cells, even more.
On the day of treatment, the patient receives billions of his own activated TIL cells through an IV, combined with material which boosts the patient's own immune system to start fighting against the melanoma cells.
Usually within 4 weeks, we see the beginning of the clinical response. In the CT scans, we see the metastases are getting smaller and smaller, and some of the metastases finally disappear. And if you achieve a complete response, it's doable, and you actually cure patients with advanced melanoma.
Danny went back to his work and daily routine. He doesn't take any pills and doesn't need treatments, just a checkup every 6 months.
That saved my life. I mean, I believe that saved my life. Without the treatment, I wouldn't be here.
Shmuel doesn't have any evidence of the disease, doesn't take any pills, and doesn't need any more treatments, just an annual checkup. After 1 month, I went for my first CT, and then Professor Schefter told me that the tumor seemed to be a bit smaller. 3 months later, I did another CT, and the tumors had shrunk again. I came back to life, went back to work, and to do the same things I did before. Dozens of patients from Israel and Europe have been treated with success at the Allen Institute for Research and Treatment of Melanoma at the Sheba Medical Center. For many patients, melanoma can be cured. Make sure to ask your doctor about it.
So this was some description of the technology and some success stories. The actual data is described in this table from 57 evaluable patients. We have combination of complete responding and partial responders in 23 of them, which is 40%, and the complete responders, which are about 10%, are long-living patients, more than 4 years now in our hands, and more than 6 years in Steve Rodenberg's hands. So, and you can see here the curves, the responders of the non and the non-responders. If you are lucky and you are in the responding population, you have very good chances to live much longer life than without these drugs. We are now doing studies of combination with other available treatments like anti-CTLA-4, ipilimumab, or PLX inhibitors in combination with AT. We are also going into elderly patients with brain metastasis and getting similar response. These are the papers that we published. First paper about the technologies that we modified, the second one about the 20 first patients, and now we are publishing the 57 patients' clinical results. So this is a summary of some cell therapy brought into clinical studies in Israel. We are doing a lot of efforts to do public relations around the adaptive immunotherapy because, as other speakers mentioned, it is very difficult to get a product approved. Big pharma do not invest in it. They invest into small molecular weight drugs, and it is difficult to do large-scale studies. So we are looking for ways to circumvent it and to get approval and to treat larger amounts of patients. To summarize, there are a few additional issues that I just want to mention. We are planning to have an international conference on regenerative medicine, translational research and industry in Israel in April 2013, and I hope you will be interested in it. And we have cards about the events and the address. It has its website already. There is also a website dedicated to clinical results in cell therapies. In Israel, we have the Ministry of Health established a committee for approval of cell-based therapies, and there is also the Association of Stem Cells with a subcommittee on industry, which I am the chairman. And all this work was done, the one that I mentioned, the Sheba Medical Center, in the appropriate collaborating groups in the center, the hematology, the oncology, orthopedic surgery, laboratory for translational research, which I am heading, the Eye Institute and the plastic surgery, and also in collaboration with the private Cobra Bank Tavolet. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have time for a couple of questions, if you want to keep 30 minutes to every speaker. Any questions from the audience?
So Avi, is there a way of categorizing melanoma patients, the responders versus the non-responders before the therapy?
Oh, that's a million-dollar question. Know that we are working on that. And one interesting thing that we are finding is that the younger the cells are, the better response they have, clinical response, not just surrogates in vitro. So they have to be young, they have to be rich in CD8 population, and they have to be in enough numbers. So you can get larger numbers but not young enough because they don't multiply. So with these combinations, we can predict in very high chances who will be the respondents.
Maybe I have a question about the cord blood stem cell that you mentioned in the beginning, especially cerebral palsy, diabetes. What is the idea behind this treatment? Is the cord blood cell as a new treatment, or is it a replacement treatment?
Well, in each of these diseases, the expectation, the hypothesis are different. For type 1 diabetes, it is an autologous treatment, and that's why it is expected that there is a resetting of the immune response, which will be less immunostimulatory. It's an autoimmune disease, and it will work more normally. So that's a theory. I mean, nobody knows really how it works, but there will be some good initial clinical results. In cerebral palsy, nobody knows. I mean, there are some theories mentioned in the arm about Parkinson effects, and probably this is what is going on.
Any other question? If not, I want to thank the speakers and the audience and to close the session. Thank you very much.